University Center for Building Simulation and Energy. So, professor.
Thank you, Chairman. Good morning. My topic here is to try to find some relationship between the energy used by buildings and the human behaviors or the occupant behaviors. Why we talking that? Because to provide a healthy building and comfort indoor climate, we do need energy. How many energy be used to provide this indoor environment? Here is some data for some countries. The horizontal one is the building energy used for operation in terms of per capita. And the vertical one is in terms of per square meter annually. Whatever you can see, there are huge differences between countries, like between the North America and Europe. Also huge differences between Europe and China, and between China and India. So where the difference come from? Then we see the history. Here I show what happened during the half century in United States. Here is also the building energy in terms of per square meters annually. You can see during this 20 years since 1950, there are big rise in energy. What happened here? Because whatever all the technique has been improved, better insulation, high efficiency of the service system, but why the energy just go up rather than go down? Same thing happened in Japan, but that's not in the 1950s, it's 1960s. Also, they only spend something like 10 years, the energy in terms of per square meters, just doubled. What caused this big rise in US and in Japan, and also some other countries in this period? What caused a huge difference in building energy between all these countries? Before we answer these questions, let's see some case in China. This building be built by the joint project between China and the US, try to demonstration of the how low energy building can be made. They try to include all the different technologies, solar PV, better insulation, good windows, good system. However, by the end, here is some data for real energy use during the operation. There are the total electricity used. And combined with other buildings with the same function, this one is demonstrated building, these are some others. I cannot say they are very high energy used, but at least not low energy. It's a similar level as other buildings. Okay, then they say this Sino Italy building that was being built in Tsinghua, where I come from. They try to use all this technology, try to reduce the real energy use. However, here is the real energy cost in turn. You see, all this is three groups of the building in the same campus with central air conditioning, split unit, or fan. And this one is one of the top, rather than one of the lowest. It's one of the top energy, you see this one. And then we can see a residential apartment. Also, this building with geothermal, the reason to make this huge difference. But why the people run this kind of pooling in so different way? Then we ask, that's because some of the rules, the family only operated when it's occupied. And some of the cooler only operated if the room is occupied. Another room, empty room, no, turn on the cooler. Then also, sometimes they fully open the windows if outdoor is not so hot. So, and also the different set point and the different starting point. All these reasons, like even the different part of the building, so when even you open windows, the natural ventilation can be very, very different rate. And you see the power used for the air conditioning is not continuously, it's always turn on, turn off. So during some time, they switch out.
And even the set point is at 26 degrees C, but they are not mean as soon as the temperature above 26 did not turn on. They have to above to certain value, something like 3 or 2 Kelvin above the set point. Then they turn on the air conditioner and cool down the room and maintain indoor at this set point. All this kind of feature makes a difference of the building. So, to now more detail, we try on some simulation to modeling what happened in that building. And we take this standard case as four time, four space with set point 24 degrees C with 1 time per hour of exchange rate. And then we design 5 different cases, such as raising the set point or the part time operation, means if the people empty, if the room empty, switch off for everything, and also raising the starting point. You see, as soon after the temperature reached to 29 degrees C, you turn on the cooler and then continue to put the set point at 26. That's normal way the people run the cooling system. And then open windows sometimes, and pass this means if the empty room switch off. Not now. So then, through the simulation, you got all the difference. You see, if in the standard case means 4 times full space, you need this electricity in terms of per square meters, and then raising the set point, part time, raising the starting temperature, open windows, and part space, and you put all the data here. You see, it's not quite cover each other. I cannot say this. This family is running this way, but at least the change for that can be well explained by all these reasons. That means just because different way to operate your building, to operate your cooling system, you got very, very different in the energy used. What about the central conditioning? There are 20 kilowatt hour, something here. That means because all space, they run 24 hours, plus pumps and fans, they reach here, this reason. So then we see another case somewhere in Yangtze River here. The temperature during the winter is not very cold, but you see, cold air here, between 0 to 10. And what happened in this air, we collect data, energy data from more than 1,000 families. The, during the winter, they use heat pump or electricity heater. The current level for heating is in this 6 to 8 kilowatt per square meter. And then we do some simulation. We learned if you put your set point at 14 degrees C with part-time part space, you only need 5 kilowatt hour per square meter. 16, you need 8. 18, you see, if you put 22 degrees C with 4 times 4 space heating the indoor, then you need this value, 35 or 36. Hopefully, at this moment, this is the current Chinese situation. But you can see how big difference can be made between different ways to operate your buildings, to operate the heating system. Okay, then we see another case, that's the campus building, university campus building in China, in Beijing, and in Philadelphia, in the United States. You can see the weather data is very close to each other, it's not a huge difference, you see, located by this one, not this, not side of the Pacific. And in Beijing one, here, they use district heating, and then you use electricity to do the cooling and do other things. Here is the mean value per square meters. You can see three group. The value is between 30 to 82, whatever. And then here is 94 buildings in Philadelphia campus. You see the value, the mean value, 230. That's huge. And that's not included the heating and cooling energy demand. And then here is the heating. because both computers use district heating, but in Beijing, the only 1/3 of gigajoules per square meters, but in Philadelphia, it's 0.84 gigajoules. And hence, cooling demand, 1 gigajoule. That's not cooling demand, cooling used, consumed. And in Beijing, also we have some data, it's only 1/4 compared with Philadelphia. If the climate are the same, if the building function are the same, why is there so huge difference? We find the main reason is these three. First, operation hours. This building in Philadelphia, you see the blue line is the electricity used during the weekend and during the weekday, during the day and during the night. They are not changed very much, almost constant. However, the electricity used in Beijing in some high standard office, you can see the day and the night, and weekday and weekend, they are very different. So they are really operated in a totally different way, continuously for 24 hours or only in working time. Then energy by fans for ventilation. The building in Philadelphia is something like 10 or more than 10 times per hour of ventilation rate, 24 hours during the day and for the whole year. So then, by calculation, you can got the only the fan they need 140 kilowatt hour per square meters. But another side, in the Chinese side, say 1 change air volume per hour and only 12 hours for the whole year, there will be 8 kilowatt hour per square meter. If only ventilated by half year, another half year, just open windows by natural ventilation, then you need 4 and 140, how much difference? That's second. Third reason is reheat. Here is a typical scheme for the 100 unit in the Philadelphia buildings. You know the 100 unit. You see, most of the energy used just against the heating and cooling rather than the real purpose. Okay? And here is the four buildings in that campus I selected randomly. And the horizontal one is outdoor temperature in France, in F. And here is the BTU for heating in the red color, for cooling is blue color. You can see almost whatever outdoor, warm or cold, over the year, the heating energy are not very big difference. And cooling also something is quite uniform. So then the question is, where the heat and the cold go? They are against each other, just being used by reheat. By reheat, that's the only reason. Only small part of the heating and cooling be really used for room climate conditions. So then they are the, in the Beijing side, the office building use frontal unit. Another side of the earth, they use VV system. They are the different, right? And then according to this scheme, we did some detailed simulation. First, put the operation hour in the same. Both sides is same rather than different. Same set point, same operation hour. But one is use frontal unit because then the occupant, sometimes the office is empty now people, so then they switch off the frontal unit, switch off everything. But for the VAV system, for the whole system, even half of the room emptied, but the system still has to be running. Only the VAV box maybe go to the minimal position of the air volume, but sometimes to maintain the indoor temperature, they need reheat. And by simulation, they are the result. The energy for cooling, energy for heating, energy for the fan. So then if you take this value, multiply by 1.8, because then you take 24 hours operation, you can quite clearly to the data of on-site measurement. Okay, the third, then how to ensure the indoor air quality? It seems there are two ways. One is fully automatically just make room is very airtight, and then take the ventilator to keep the indoor air quality. Some cases you calculated, they need the fan, need something like 40 kilowatt per square meters. But then if you use the open control, open windows, you feel indoor is not nice. So not only do you need just natural ventilation, there are also a modeling to see these two cases. And the energy is really something different. Even with heat recovery, with very airtight room, but they need more energy combined with open windows, just give the occupants the power to open windows or close windows when they feel they need outdoor air. So then we believe the power to control indoor climate is the most important demand for the open. What means power to control indoor climate? Include to control the window state, to control the air conditioning state, rather than control the indoor temperature, control the lighting, control the ventilation state. Oh. So after all this kind of study, and also then we learn, we study some history books, we learn why in US in the early 1950s, there are big jump during that time, because in the residential buildings, at that time, they use window unit for air conditioning, the window can open. And now, they use central air conditioning in the residential buildings, so only the window, the window cannot be opened. That's different. For the office building, at that time, they can open windows, use local AC, use local controlled lighting. But now, the window, most of the building window cannot open, they use VAV, they use centralized control for lighting. They are make the huge difference. And for Japan, we learned it was low indoor temperature for residential buildings, but now turn to the central system with closed window and mechanical ventilation. For office building, same thing happened. That's also can understand why there are big reasons. So the huge difference in building energy are caused by differences in lifestyle and building usage models. I believe this can be explained, all the data, why like that. Then, my college professor, Xinhao Taylor, he leads this Annex 53, IEA. We believe all these six factors gave a big influence on the real building energy use. Normally, the people only think about the construction, the building shape, the building insulation level, the technical system, and what climate. However, these three factors give more strong influence on the real energy use, the how occupants actions, the way for operation the buildings, and the set point and the schedule, how operation your systems. These three things may be more influence, more large influence, then that's three factors. Maybe we should think about something about that. And what happened, in fact, if this is the service level provided by the building system, and this is the energy used, the relationship between these two factors is not linear, not never linear process, it's a very, very non-linear process. If the building is very poor served, then by something you improve the building service level, you increase some of the energy, you reach that point. However, if you want to further more better serve, you need a huge increase of the energy use. Then the question is, where we should stop? We don't want to go this way. And of course, we don't want to go this way. There are some points we should stop. Rather than go to the base service. That's not the point. And we can think, if there are 7 billion in the world population living the same way as what USA 300 million does, then we need 180% of the carbons based on renewable with a number of high tech. Maybe this works for OECD. But Then also another way to reach this low energy is to change or to keep the 3 feet lifestyle and usage model to improve the indoor climate with some suitable technologies that's easy to reach with acceptable indoor environmental and more practice for developing countries. Here is a good example, it's an office building in Shenzhen. You can see also something like high-rise, but they are trying to make a very good connection to outdoor at every floor. And they got very, very good natural ventilation. And also the natural ventilation can be controlled if they block this. If outdoor wind is too strong, too light, then I go this way. If too strong, they can open this, make the air some air go this way, and make good indoor natural ventilation. And also you see the natural lighting, even for conference room. In the May days, it's very cold near Hong Kong. They still can open the door to buy good natural ventilation. But then also when really hot outdoor, they can close all these kind of walls and run the air conditioning system. And this is the annual energy electricity used. You can see for heating and cooling and ventilation, they only use 16 kilowatt hour per square meters annually. It's much lower combined with normal office buildings in the same area. And the total electricity used is 44 kilowatt hour per square meter annually for that building. So the new architecture plus new HVAC system to support green occupants behavior may be another approach to reach the target of low energy and high IEQ demand. However, then the building code, the energy saving techniques used should also be related with lifestyle and usage models. Here is some problem. For instance, in China, for the Shanghai, in our code, building energy code, it says, as soon as the HVAC electricity used less than 55.1 kilowatt hour per square meters, it meet this energy efficiency buildings. That's under this kind of conditions to calculate. However, in the real case, more than 70% of families use less than 1.5 kilowatt hour per square meter during the year. It's only less than 1/3 of this target. This doesn't mean all the buildings meet this standard code. That's because different way to operate this building. So, should we take this as a reference model for design, for evaluate, for study building energy efficiency? No, that's something wrong. But some people believe it is just a reference case. It can be used for comparison, so to judge relative building energy performance. However, the question is, if a building uses less energy than another at this reference case, does it always lower than us at all different cases? That's a big challenge. Here are some examples, like in Shanghai, same area. Do we need air tightness? Very, very good air tightness. If we do full time, then air tightness very good. If we do full time but with different set point, then natural ventilation becomes very important. Then you can see, in this case, if keep the set point 24, this air tightness. So this one, less energy combined with normal one. But if the same points like that, there are not big difference. Even this one is slowly lower than this attained one. Another case, as what I just mentioned, for residential buildings, if you need full time, full space air conditioning, then the central air conditioner system works better. But if you do part time, part space, cooling for the residential, you can see the decentralized are much better than the centralized. Okay, the another case is air conditioning for office buildings. If you do full time, okay, and you see different demand do need a different type of the system and also the district cooling system. If the load is really not changeable during the day, 24 hours during the weekend, then not doesn't wrong for district cooling. However, if you do part-time, space, the load is really variable during the day, then the digital cooling doesn't work. It will very poor efficiency. Here is also an example for domestic hot water system. And do we need a centralized system to provide domestic hot water? We find it's very sensitive on how much water you need. If you need this like range, like Japan, like USA, maybe centralized this does make sense. But if the demand is very small, the efficiency will be very low. Here is some case in China. The driven is how many energy you need to produce this hot water. And this is the heat lost through the pipe, and this is the pumped energy. You can see until this one, very high demand in the terminal, then seems high efficiency, but very low demand, low efficiency. Okay, so then for whatever, for design, for evaluation, for lighting buildings, you do need the right reference model rather than use this kind of standard model for time for space. Maybe the real model, real operation model should be used to evaluate, to design, to do lighting system. Right? So the difference in energy use due to different usage model is much larger than due to different techniques used. Whether a technique can save energy is highly dependent on the real usage model. And different usage model do need different technologies to save energy. Here is a very good example produced by my colleagues in Japan. See, here they are the energy used for family unit per year in gigajoule. And they list different technologies here. You see the heat pump, they take highest energy because the four times four space operation, 1 second, 1 minute, okay. And you see all these different technologies, they take part-time four space. So there are something different, but all lower than this four times four space model. And this catalog, part-time part space, is much lower. Then make the Germans believe maybe to save energy, they should encourage people to use this model rather than that one. So, a conclusion, different usage model or demand need different technology for energy system. Different usage model cause large difference in energy use than that caused by different technology. And we shouldn't work only on the standard usage model, but also think about other usage models and find out different solutions for the environmental quality, the last. So then what we need for academic studies, we should set up the theoretical frame for occupant behavioral study, because now it's not so many research on this field. Make clean definition on OB, qualitative description on OB. What means occupant behavior? How to numerically to deal with that? And then we need large scale view on the OB, on different cultures and classification of the OB, set up some type of OBs and the simulation of that, as well as the influence of energy, and study low building energy technique for different type of OB. That's right. The future solution for indoor air quality should be suitable technology and plus green OB. Thank you. That's right.